Putting a positive spin on the unsellable now on BBC4, how the country's biggest agencies sold our politicians to us in The Ad Men and Number 10.
Their job is to sell aspiration and to persuade us which soap powder to use, what we should drink, wear and drive. But how do they sell probably the most undesirable product in the world? Politicians. In pursuit of power, the political parties spend millions trying to win our votes. And they employ some of the most creative people in Britain to do it. Ad men.
I don't intend to end this campaign packaged like cornflakes.
This is the story of the methods used. The memorable slogan.
We tend to follow Churchill's axiom. The only original remark is something that hasn't been said for a long time.
How they package the leader.
A man to trust.
The knocking copy.
You go for the Achilles heel of the opposition, is what you try and do.
And how sometimes they just go that little bit too far. A general election is imminent, and your advertising agency has won the governing party's account. Your brief? To ensure that they get back into number 10. As admin, you can decide how to sell power. You can sell the party, sell the leader, even sell individual policies. But first, you must write a catchy slogan to appear throughout the campaign, encapsulating in a line why someone should vote for your party.
Britain is going backwards.
That slogan must be centred on change. Good or bad, making us fearful or hopeful, asking us to stick with what we have or try something new.
Tomorrow will be better than today.
It's almost inevitable that if you're the opposition, you have to say to people it's time for a change, because you're asking them to make a change. And if you're the government, you have to say to people, don't make a change, or there's no need to make a change, but it's all about change.
I think the fundamental thing is everything's great, don't take the risk on the other lot. And when you're in opposition, it's everything's dreadful, it's time for a change. I mean, at its most fundamental, those are the two strategies.
The slogan emerged in the 50s, when political advertising was taking a quantum leap forwards. The Conservatives hired a trend-setting agency,
Coleman, Prentice and Varley.
Coleman, Prentice and Varley, to mastermind their future election advertising after their shock defeat in the 1945 ballot. CPV was celebrated for promoting the fashion houses, Jaeger and Elizabeth Arden.
CPV was a very conservative agency. It had ex-government ministers on its board. It worked for what was then called the War House, the Ministry of Defence. I mean, the agency was, in any case, the most famous British agency in the 50s and 60s. It's gone now, sadly.
It was the very early days of communication. It was gentlemen, Colonel Varley, the Colonel, as he was known. It was a different gentlemanly era.
The agency used pioneering market research to identify a new type of Conservative voter for Harold Macmillan's election campaign, the lower middle class Tory.
Who do you think you vote for?
Conservatives, as usual.
Why usual?
Well, I think they're the best party, for one thing, and but definitely the best in every way, I think.
They targeted the housewife and clerical worker in a series of innovative ads. The party built a war chest for election adverts and spent the equivalent of £8 million on the campaign. And the agency came up with the defining slogan for Tory elections. Life's better with the Conservatives. Don't let Labour ruin it.
Don't let Labour ruin it is one of the basic core strategies of political communication. The other one is time for a change. And CPV, as they were known, did very well with that strategy for many years.
When they say don't let Labour ruin it, I say to them Britain can be better than this.
Who would you like to see win the election?
Whatever the slogan, it needs to register with the voter.
I think the present government have done a fair job, you know, but tolling for a change.
When Macmillan won by a landslide, some in the Labour Party said it was immoral for the Tories to rely on the hidden persuaders to help win power. But when Harold Wilson took over as Labour leader in the early 60s, he decided it was time for a change and employed a handful of professional admin to promote the party. But all were unpaid volunteers.
I was working for an advertising agency, and some of the very large accounts that there were in the world, like Procter & Gamble and people like that.
Is it any good?
I'll say it is.
Yes, Grandma.
Did I ask you, Leslie?
No, Grandma.
We girls don't need your help.
I was an odd person in that I was both politically motivated, but also I had been spending a lot of time in building up a reputation in the advertising industry. And there weren't many of us at that time. It was a new era, in a way, for the party. And Harold, when I made my first presentation to him, teased me a little bit about the fact that, oh, I see you've got those charts, that's what ad men do.
David Kingsley pitched a suitably 60s version of Time for a Change called Let's Go with Labour. But Wilson needed some persuasion as he'd spotted a double entente.
Let's Go with Labour was part of what we were proposing. And Harold intervened and said, well, up where I come from in the north, being on the go means being on the po. Ha ha ha, you see.
Despite the lavatorial connotation, it proved a winning tagline. In the next election, Labour's admin came up with a new one, underlining the word no.
It was really saying to the public, do you or don't you trust the Labour Party as the government?
Not everyone liked it or Wilson. And it was not hard for Edward Heath's Conservative Party to offer something better.
Mr. Edward Heath, the next Prime Minister!
Welcome to the first edition of A Better Tomorrow.
Mr. Wilson and his colleagues have certainly given us plenty of words to take them at. Let's look at a few of them.
We were told, you know, Labour government works.
Labour's losing slogans in 1970. When it comes down to it, aren't their ideals yours as well? And Labour's got life and soul. For Mrs. Thatcher's first election campaign, the admin devised variations on their tried and tested theme.
Our general message was, life will be better with the Conservatives. The overriding slogan was Time for a Change, which was the point we were trying to make. We had another one which I always loved, which was, don't just hope for a better life, vote for it.
The reason they get ad men to reiterate these very familiar themes is that they can make it fresher, perhaps, if they're lucky, and make it more relevant to the changing vernacular or something of that kind. But generally, it is true they hire these ad men to say the same thing.
While fighting her third campaign as leader, Margaret Thatcher was said to be delighted with the regurgitated Tory slogan, Britain is great again, don't let Labour wreck it.
We tend to follow Churchill's axiom, the only original remark is something that hasn't been said for a long time.
10 years later, John Major's admin tried to excite the voter with yet another version of their old catchline, Britain is booming, don't let Labour blow it. He lost the election. When in power, New Labour had something similar. Britain is working, don't let the Tories take us back, for their glitzy new employment campaign.
Sometimes a slogan does reinforce the prejudices or beliefs that you wish to reinforce, But more often than not, it serves a similar function to a full stop.
For AdMen, the slogan is perhaps not the most creative contribution to selling power. For real impact, you might sometimes need something else. But in an industry that's highly regulated, amazingly, political adverts aren't required to be honest, decent, or true, allowing you to knock the opposition and say pretty much whatever you like.
How have we got into this state?
In 1970, Labour's Prime Minister Harold Wilson was facing his third election.
We're on the attack in this election, as you know.
The AdMen needed to stop the fickle electorate voting for a change. They had to make the Tories look as unattractive a proposition as possible. Labour's AdMen David Kingsley had a revolutionary idea and devised a series of phrases to be the basis of their strategy. He pitched it to the party. Go on the offensive by being offensive.
We might use such phrases as, they're the wizards that weren't, sheep in wolf's clothing, there's nothing as stale as yesterday's men, look back in anguish. Now, I think this is where yesterday's men was born and eventually became the way that we did it when we got to the election.
Portraying the opposition as failed has-beens, Kingsley commissioned clay models of the Conservative Party front bench to be used in a groundbreaking advertisement.
Sir Alex Douglas, Hume, Richard Maudlin, Edward Heath, Enoch Powell, all names that were very important in the Conservative Party at that time.
The caricatures appeared on billboards around the country under the derogatory title Yesterday's Men. It was the opening shot in the 1970 election campaign. But some felt it just wasn't British and was a bit below the belt.
There was a tremendous outcry, particularly from the opposition press, on their front pages, accusing us of being rude about other politicians. Well, that was another time, wasn't it? I mean, today it's common practice. But we didn't think we were doing that. We were just reminding people of who the alternative people were.
The ads were soon pulled, but the damage was done.
I remember seeing Yesterday's Men, and I've always been a Conservative, I've been a Conservative candidate, but I thought that one got in between the ribs. It shows the value of these sorts of posters in setting an agenda. It helps shape the opinion formers, the journalists, it lines up the attack. It is a focusing device to focusing communication on the same target.
When Wilson lost that election, Yesterday's Men was cited as partly responsible.
Certainly, people within the Labour Party all say that Harold Wilson put a lot of the blame on the advertisement and he was less than generous to the people who had brought it about.
The makers of Pepsi commercials were the production company who came to the aid of the Conservative Party.
I think we struck oil here, Phyllis.
The Tory leader, Edward Heath, wanted to project a clean, wholesome image.
What's he saying, Phyllis? It's getting a bit passionate.
He says you owe him 20 pesetas for the Pepsi.
Jeremy Scott was the man of the moment and worked on their election films.
We, Garrett, suggested an armory of negatives which would destroy the enemy positions, but he vetoed it utterly. He said, no dirty tricks, no sleaze. He wanted the moral high ground. However, we produced a host of negatives and the moral high ground wasn't what he got.
Do you recognize this? It's a frozen wage packet. Mr. Wilson put it on the market in 1966. Vote Labour on June the 18th, and you'll get it again. In the family size.
The tone of the individual commercials was about as negative as you could get.
Since Mr. Wilson came to power, this is what he's done to your pound.
One was a pair of scissors snipping up a treasury note to show how rapidly the value of the pound was deteriorating.
1974, 11 shillings. 1975, 10 shillings. The 10 bob pound. Only your vote can stop him.
Edward Heath's victory proved that negative advertising on the right issues could be a vote winner. But knocking the opposition's policies wasn't new. In the late 1920s, the Conservatives made their first political ads for a new medium, film. One attacked Labour for being the party of high unemployment and increased taxation, constantly popular themes in their election campaigns.
Political advertising is absolutely in the tradition of propaganda. There's not a huge difference between propaganda and political advertising, and there's not a huge difference between political persuasive devices from whatever part of the spectrum, left or right, they come.
Denigrating your opponent can be a powerful persuader, showing the difference between parties. But there was a problem.
Movie theatres were not keen on taking political propaganda, so they got the idea of sending around mobile vans, cinema vans, where they would show their films.
Going negative might even have helped Stanley Baldwin to win power in 1931.
They would go to the seaside or particular towns that the Conservative Party wanted to target. They would set up, they would have a canopy over them. They would start showing films and they would try and attract a crowd in. And that's basically how they worked. And they were very impressed with their own success. They were a novelty, of course, because nobody else was doing this. And cinema was still pretty new.
The cinema ad was revived 50 years later by London's most fashionable ad agency, Saatchi and Saatchi.
Tell you what I don't want to see.
What's that?
Labour in power again.
Labour in power? Was that the Marx Brothers?
Nah, another bunch of comedians.
Coming shortly, the Conservatives.
It was the late 1970s. The country was falling apart. Labour had been in power for 4 years and unemployment had risen to almost 1.5 million.
We're the people that are unemployed. We're the ones that are bloody suffering. Come and meet us. Hey?
The Saatchis were two brothers with a reputation for highly imaginative campaigns, including a number of amusing public health ads.
And we're just 30 laps to go, eh?
Come along, darling, walkies. Come on, come along, Roger.
It may come as a nasty shock, but people need exercising just as much as dogs.
They had done some wonderful work for the Health Education Council. They did these great ads against smoking. They did ads about disease. They showed they could do communication on public interest topics.
Hang on. Yeah. Where you go?
You'll put more effort into everything you do.
These ads impressed the Conservatives and their first woman leader, Margaret Thatcher.
Roger.
So the Saatchis were hired to bring their flair and imagination to her election campaign.
A few minutes exercise every day could add so much to your life.
Maurice Saatchi wrote most of the strategy, and Charles Saatchi oversaw all the creative work. Charles is the genius, Maurice is the interpreter of his genius. They love political advertising. They talk about it all the time. We all do. We're all obsessed with it.
Saatchi and Saatchi didn't disappoint. They created one of the most effective negative political ads ever made. Labour isn't working was a clever wordplay highlighting the growing ranks of those on the dole and the ineffectiveness of the Labour Party. Posters started appearing in the summer of 1978.
Mrs. Thatcher thought that it was rather risky to put the word Labour in the headline because it would promote the other side. It took me a while to explain it doesn't really work like that, and I think she got it in the end. It was a brilliant poster, captured the imagination, because it was one of those thoughts that just touches people and makes people say, "Oh, that rings true to me." it spread discontent, and it suggested time for change.
We didn't say let's do negative advertising, we just did what was the most thought-provoking, stirring stuff. Now, Labour had been in office for a wee while, so inevitably, to make the case for your own party, you're going to be highlighting or pointing to the inadequacies of the government.
The accepted wisdom is that negative campaigning is what works, what has the greatest effect. It's certainly easier. It's easier to write. All the famous pieces of communication, I think it's true to say, have been knocking copy, as we call it. You listen to the news, read your tabloid press, read any press, actually. Why are newspapers full or not full of everything that's gone right that day? People aren't interested in hearing it.
If you think that the competition is for the undecided voter, that is the beginning and end of the competition in an election, and a negative ad reminds you and reinforces the view that is pre-existing that perhaps these people aren't as good as they'd like you to believe, then you'll think, yes, I was dithering, but I'm going to go that way. And that's the rather simple way that negative advertising is supposed to work and frequently does work.
The negative ad can fuel controversy and make an impact. And Labour Isn't Working certainly succeeded in rattling its target, the socialist government.
Great joy of it was that we didn't spend much money of it, but Labour took exception to it. In particular, Dennis Healey criticised it.
It isn't surprising, really, when you come to think of it, that she's chosen Saatchi and Saatchi, the specialists in deodorants and detergents, to cleanse and sweeten the image of extremism and division which she's created by all she's said and done.
It was typical of the Labour Party at the time, who have always, in their hearts, believed that advertising men and marketing men are some kind of sons of the devil, who make people do things they don't want to do and distort society.
But Labour Isn't Working is thought to have affected the course of British political history.
Yet it's hard to prove this beyond all doubt, but it's certainly a contributory factor to James Callaghan not calling an election that autumn, which almost certainly led to his, helped bring about his pretty heavy defeat the following year.
Callaghan's defeat looked inevitable after a winter of industrial action crippled Britain.
Excuse me, is this a queue in the 50p stalls?
Oh, no. This is a cure for serious operations.
And Thatcher gave Saatchis a free rein to capitalise on the chaos. She trusted them to find the most powerful techniques to help her win the election.
Asking you to help us in this, the most crucial election, for putting Britain on a different road.
The high-profile and largely negative campaign contributed to her success and made Saatchi's a household name. It was their springboard to become the biggest ad agency in Britain. Britain's first female PM swept into number 10, taking Saatchi's with her.
I think people saw that combative, challenging advertising could work. We've since learned you have to be very careful about it, and most comparative advertising isn't effective. But people felt, look, this has been bold, this has been challenging, let's do it for our brand.
In the early 80s, the Conservatives weren't working. Rioting erupted in Britain's inner cities. Hundreds of factories closed. And by 1983, unemployment rose to over 3 million. With the general election underway, Labour's new leader, Michael Foot, had yet to make an impression.
Michael Foot is the leader of the Labour Party. Michael Foot speaks for the Labour Party, and we are in support of the manifesto policy.
Why was it necessary in the middle of an election campaign to be clear who the leader is?
There's no such question ever arose.
He wanted to win on a radical socialist manifesto, and the Tory admin seized on it. The Saatchis had a talent for identifying and exploiting their opponent's Achilles heel, and suggested that a vote for Labour was a vote for extremism.
We're seeing, isn't it?
The remarkable thing was, if you looked at what they stood for, and what the Communist Party stood for, there was hardly any gap between the two. So we decided, wouldn't it be interesting to do this, an ad comparing these two things? So then we came up with this headline, which just said, like your manifesto, comrade. And we had these two identical looking manifestos on the top of the page. So it's just a very simple, typical us kind of ad, really.
They've done brilliantly negative ads where they spot where the weakness is and exaggerate it and amuse people with it. And it works, I think.
Unlike Margaret Thatcher, Michael Foote didn't believe in image creation or managing the media, but even he realised that to get into number 10, he needed the admin's help.
Bird's Angel Delight. You'll be surprised just how deliciously light it is.
To improve their lacklustre performance, they recruited the men behind Angel Delight.
Bird's Angel Delight. It's deliciously light.
It was the first time in its history that Labour paid professional ad men, spending the equivalent of almost £2 million in the 1983 election campaign. Johnny Wright won the account for his company. But not everyone in the party was happy to become a brand.
We had the absolute haters who hated us with a passion that was pretty rare, really, in business. And the people who were cautious and expectant that we could wave some magic wand and do something magical.
Homelessness, waste, desolation.
Wright's agency were asked to produce five 10-minute election broadcasts and half a dozen posters and press ads in less than a month. Some politicians asked to front the campaign had difficulty.
Think positive, vote positive. Oh, such a bloody stupid thing to say, isn't it? Think positive, act positive, vote Labour. I'm sorry, but it is, you know. It doesn't come off the tongue nicely. Think positive, act positive, vote Labour. Okay, sorry.
Right, ready? Take three.
Think positive, act positive, vote Labour.
Labour were 15 points adrift in the polls. Every morning, Johnny Wright would meet with campaign managers at Labour HQ to discuss what they would do.
Somebody would say, we need to do something about the health service, and that was reckoned to be our brief. So I went back to the agency, which was about 15, 20 minutes away in my extremely old Mini, and said, it's the National Health Service, lads, and we'd do something about the National Health Service.
Despite the positive slogan, Labour's advertising was reassuringly negative. It showed life under the Tories, gutters full of the unemployed, pensioners under the screw, young people on the scrap heap.
We developed a sort of gruesome negative to do with the health service or school leavers. Big visual headline and then a bit of explanatory copy about what we were talking about and what Labour was going to do to relieve this problem.
Michael Foote promises he will bring down unemployment.
Meanwhile, Saatchi and Saatchi were working overtime to remind the voters quite how dreadful life under Labour would be.
The fact is, every Labour government in history has increased unemployment. Do you remember what it was like before the last election? What it was like at the beginning of 79? The rubbish piled high in the streets, ambulances left unmanned, the dead unburied.
Labour's ad agency, Johnny Wright and Partners, wanted to respond with a devastating and highly personal attack, likening Margaret Thatcher to the gangster in the song Mac the Knife.
We produced what we thought was really fantastic, aggressive, anti-Thatcher advertising that the world would talk about. big, strong visual, strong headline, bit of a pun, Britons like puns, and then some absolutely unarguable copy points. She slashed the jobs of 2 million people. She's filleted British industry. She's knifed us in the regions. You would have had millions of people being forced to see it because it would have been on television. But the Labour Party absolutely withdrew from it and thought, no, no, you can't do that. No, no, and it never ran.
The election result was never in doubt. The Conservative slick campaign ran rings round the opposition.
As it happens, half the advertising was cancelled at the end of the campaign by Cecil Parkinson, the then chairman, because it was unnecessary. We were so far ahead, we couldn't lose.
Nothing really changed. Millions of pounds have been spent by all the parties to, in a way, to go nowhere, which is a sadness, particularly if you're a Labour supporter.
I therefore declare Neil Kinnock elected as leader of the Labour Party.
Labour's overwhelming defeat resulted in the election of a moderniser. Neil Kinnock became the new Labour Party leader.
On your last trip, did you discover what the Earth people eat? They eat a great many of these.
Kinnock was very image conscious and turned to the men who'd used aliens to sell potatoes to help pulverise the opposition.
They are clearly a most primitive people.
For mash, get smash.
Labour was still trailing the Tories in the polls, and the party's own polling research revealed key policies like renationalisation and nuclear disarmament were overwhelmingly unpopular with voters.
Frankly, the fight in 1987 was for survival for the Labour Party and just to get through that with minimum damage.
They ran a series of ads attacking the government. One highlighted the rising rates of crime. Another, Mrs. Thatcher's callous attitude to public sector workers, the young, the old, and the vulnerable.
It was almost all newspaper, full-page newspaper advertisements. And we charged about all over the place, criticising the government for its lack of heart, its lack of care, largely, things like that. Its failure in economic performance. And we darted about, and the reason we darted about was not to get stuck on any one subject where we could be crucified by the Conservative government, who knew perfectly well that we had these extraordinarily unpopular policies.
But it was a question about defence that set the campaign alight. During a television interview, Kinnock was reported as saying he wouldn't retaliate in the face of a nuclear strike. It led to a spate of terrible headlines. Saatchi and Saatchi pounced.
When you're working on a political campaign, things happen incredibly quickly. And, you know, you need to be, you're working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You're listening to the media, you're waiting for things to come up. Someone says the ad's approved, we need it up on a poster hoarding tomorrow. You've got 12 hours or something. Usually these things take 2 or 3, 4 weeks. And so we sort of tossed a coin, me and the guy who I was with, who was going to put on the uniform. I won, fortunately, so he put on the uniform. We then took a quick snap of him, sent it off to get processed, and printed the poster, had it up the next morning. And it made quite an impact. Norman Tebbit was the chairman. He would sign off all the work. And I think actually it's probably fair to say most of that campaign was actually run and approved by Shirley, who was his PA, because Shirley had to approve everything as a voice of the people.
But in the final week of the 87 election campaign, a new poll put Labour just behind the Tories. Overnight, Margaret Thatcher lost confidence in Saatchi's. The Conservative Party secretly turned to Tim Bell, who had left the company to start up his own agency to come up with alternative ads.
She wanted to get across that the Conservatives had been very successful, that if you rejected them now, you were throwing away a successful team for an unknown team that might well fail.
Bell's agency produced hard-hitting ads that were arguably even more negative than Saatchi's.
I pinched the line from David Winnersham's 59 campaign, Britain's a success, don't let Labour ruin it. She absolutely loved them. She thought they were exactly what she wanted. The ads were imposed on Saatchi and Saatchi, who furious and hated it and hated me and hated everything connected with it, and they changed the bottom line to Britain's great again, don't let Labour wreck it.
Margaret Thatcher put her faith in them, spending £3 million in the last 4 days of the campaign and winning by a landslide. But by 1992, she'd been replaced by John Major. The economy was in recession, interest rates were at 10%, and many homeowners were stuck in negative equity. Neil Kinnock said his was now the party of economic competence.
Now is the time for our country to start pulling together.
You can't really rubbish the opposition in quite the same way because they're, bless them, they haven't done anything. They've just been opposing all the time. So this idea came up that we should cost all their promises.
Such's explosive idea was Labour's tax bombshell. The admin working for Kinnock were blown away.
I think the Labour tax bombshell campaign was quite the best piece of political advertising probably since the Second World War, because it was an excellent example of a combination of an extremely good bit of thinking about the vulnerability of Labour and then a very dramatic and simple and noticeable visual. And the timing was very good. People were feeling extremely vulnerable at the time.
Labour's tax bombshell is something that sort of went into the language, is still in the language. But we're also coming up with the figure. What was their bombshell? What was it going to cost the average family? And once we had that fact, then we could run with that fact, come up with the imagery.
You won't win people over because the poster is a relatively weak medium for penetrate the brain. There's no music, there's no sound. If you look at some of the best American political communication or even some of the party broadcasts, you've got a whole bigger range of emotional weaponry. In 7 seconds, you don't change anybody's mind. You reinforce a belief, you create some controversy, you light the bonfire of publicity, but you seldom change a mind.
The bombshell idea became the centerpiece in an equally destructive election broadcast.
The tax bombshell broadcast was little more than a man painting the sign on the bomb. I mean, that was sort of it. But you get one thing across.
The average taxpayer would end up being hit by an extra £1,000 tax bill.
The point about advertising is that it has to feed into a current perception. It can strengthen it, it can boost it, it can push it forward. But unless there is a perception, then the advertising won't work. And why the tax bombshell in 1992 worked was because there was still a lack of confidence amongst enough members of the electorate, particularly the swing voters, that Labour had put aside its old apparent commitments to high taxation, as people saw it, unnecessarily high taxation, for that advertisement to be very effective.
The experts can't say conclusively that the bombshell ad lost Labour the election. There were other negative attacks that followed, and a hostile Conservative press also waded in.
We're all right!
The triumphalism of Labour's pre-election Sheffield rally further alienated the floating voters.
It's quite difficult to ever pinning down the effect of any ad or campaign during an election. And many people have run the numbers and said that it has no effect. I think it self-evidently does have an effect on the party and how effective the party is and how the party feels and acts, therefore, and talks and behaves. And if you can get the confidence going and the focus going within the party itself, I mean, that's enough in itself, that everyone's saying the same thing, the same single message. They're not arguing amongst themselves.
So if saying your policies are better doesn't work and negative advertising backfires, there's another option. Sell the leader. They're the most recognised symbol of a political brand, and with your help, he or she might just cast a persuasive spell over the voter.
Look, this isn't the first of the Python repeats. It's a party political, so I'll give you 5 seconds to switch over.
In the past, the leaders didn't want the admin's help. They sold themselves.
I think we can be fairly satisfied the way things have gone lately, don't you, Ram?
Yes, but we've got through our programme very well. I've just come from the House, and we've right up to date.
The first time ad men were drafted in to polish a leader's image was in the early 70s. Ted Heath was diffident, stuffy, and remote. And in a groundbreaking broadcast, he reluctantly agreed to be repackaged to make him appear more human.
Cold. Aloof. Distant. These were the kind of words the press were always ready to trot out about Ted Heath. But as the election got into its stride, they began to use them less. Heath was a man come to life and clearly enjoying himself. And then, as the days shortened, his message began to get through. Or perhaps it's the quality of the man that's begun to get through. People have begun to realize that this isn't just another politician talking. Perhaps he's not an easy man to know. But when they know him, people feel he's a man worth knowing, a man to trust.
Margaret Thatcher was only too happy to be dressed up and marketed.
If you've got a good thing to sell, use every single capacity you can to sell it. Enough is enough.
No, enough is enough. Mm. It's a lowering, not a raising. It's
enough is enough.
That's it.
To say to the government of the day, enough is enough.
Margaret Thatcher was the best product to sell. The products they were then selling, nice guys in lots of ways, weren't nearly as good. So part of the problem is the quality of the product, not just the quality of the communication.
Kinnock had a bombastic persona which needed a makeover. But he did have a way with words.
If Margaret Thatcher wins on Thursday, I warn you not to be ordinary. I warn you not to be young. I warn you not to fall ill. And I warn you not to grow old.
The question was how to promote Neil appeal and relaunch Labour. The answer? To get a glossy commercials maker, or better still, the director of the Oscar-winning blockbuster Chariots of Fire.
A Welshman, and he's a great guy, Neil, but he wasn't sort of what they call telegenic, and so we decided to try and up his image and show people that actually what he was a passionate and deeply political man with people's interests at heart.
Hudson made what's dubbed Kinnock the Movie.
I think that the real privilege of being strong is the power that it gives you to help people who are not strong. I think the real privilege of being fit.
It's a highly flattering promo trying to reinvent the man.
Is the ability that that gives you to give others a helping hand.
I think it broke new ground in terms of being a biographical film. And obviously, we now know we vote for people, not for policies or politicians. We want to know the people.
Both of my parents died at the back end of November and December 1971, within a few days of each other. That was a shattering experience. But I had this immense good fortune of having Glennis and Steve.
I liked him a bit more at the end, I trusted him a bit more, and I respected him a bit more at the end. And those are three really important boxes to tick for any boss or leader that you're going to have. So I think it was impressive on all accounts.
It was an effective piece of political advertising, and it changed that political advertising, I think. And it increased its popularity overnight by 16%, something like that, 15 or 16%.
They can't be trotting down at Times Square to pick out the merchandise.
John Major, too, looked to Hollywood and to the director of another Oscar winner, Midnight Cowboy.
Hey, I'm walking here! I'm walking here! Up yours, you son of a bitch! You don't talk me that way!
You see the house ahead with the two white arches immediately opposite there. That is where we lived. Now, is it still there?
John Schlesinger chose a more documentary style with Major.
It's still there.
travelling around Brixton in South London and playing on his humble beginnings.
We used to come in and buy kippers.
Well, we still sell the kippers.
I had some kippers.
He'd said to me at sort of 18, 19, you're going to be a politician. I said, forget it. Anything else, anything but being a politician.
Why, on what grounds? Why?
Because I thought politicians were complete pains in the backside.
For Tony Blair's, something slightly different. The admin brought in documentary maker Molly Deneen to give his film cinema verite authenticity.
You just have to do it. People have got to understand things can change. I mean, it's just so daft to think they couldn't be better.
But if your leader can't win over the voters with their sincerity, it's probably time for the hard sell. To ignore them and go for the jugular, with a personal attack on the opposition's top man.
Party leaders are the most recognisable brand image of the party. And if you attack the party leader, it's a quick and easy and understandable way to most floating voters of attacking the party.
Getting personal is nothing new either. In the early 80s, Saatchi's produced an ad showing a picture of Michael Foot with the headline, "Even pensioners are better off with the Conservatives," but even Mrs. Thatcher wouldn't buy it. But as the 1997 election approached, the Conservatives were mired in sleaze. So, how to deflect attention from it? Well, get insultingly personal and run a political ad that would become the first ever to be banned.
John Major was deeply unpopular. The Conservatives were very unpopular. As a party, their image was bad. And we were confronted with a hopeless task. We had to find something wrong with New Labour, because New Labour was a piece of genius.
We have changed the Labour Party. Now the Labour Party wants to earn your trust to change Britain.
Blair was fantastically impressive. He was dressing up to be all things to all people, and it was very hard. We had to find a campaign idea.
I remember sitting around and people saying, there's something, when you look at him, there's something just not quite, is there something not quite trustworthy about what's behind those eyes, that smile, that look, that image, you know? Is he someone who people will trust?
The Conservatives went to the new Saatchi agency, M&C Saatchi, in the hope that they'd come up with an idea that would demolish Tony Blair and rebranded party New Labour. What they created became an advertising legend.
We'd always been able to say the Tories never put taxes up, taxes have gone up. So a lot of the really important claims that had given us the armour behind the campaigns that we'd done for the Tories, we'd lost them. The idea then was that since we'd lost our claims, we'd have a far more emotional campaign.
The image they created was one of the most memorable in advertising history.
The guy who art directed it, I remember, he took someone's eyes, a colleague in the office actually, just took a shot of them and was looking at them on a bit of paper and then turned them upside down and went, wow, that's creepy.
The controversial Blair Demon Eyes advert appeared only once in three Sunday newspapers with the catchline, New Labour, New Danger. It was part of a peering eye campaign.
We came up with these eyes, subsequently called the Demon Eyes, and that these eyes would be peering at you from wherever. Nothing definite you could put your finger on, but malevolent eyes just sort of keeping an eye on you.
Sorry, you must be careful with these flashlights. It's making my eyes red.
While Blair tried to laugh it off, it was immediately criticised by his party and the church.
And now it's the devil with the demon eyes. Look, can't we just go back to Bambi?
I have to say, it never occurred to anyone that they would be called demon eyes, that it would be, you know, counted as having a religious impact.
It caused offence, obviously, in certain quarters, much comment. I think largely negative, I think it's fair to say, at the time. I remember thinking myself, was this the right thing to have done? Was it going to be successful? And probably thinking it was an error running it. Then it got withdrawn.
The Advertising Standards Authority banned the ad for its offensive portrayal of Tony Blair, but despite the ruling, the industry magazine Campaign named Demon Eyes Poster of the Year.
In terms of getting publicity, it was a fantastic piece of advertising, and that's why other advertisers like it. Politically, you can argue that it was an awful mistake.
It was brilliantly conceived creatively, but we never really solved the question. We never really decided what it was we thought was dangerous about Labour.
It's a good demonstration of one of the problems which people have, and they don't understand how the brain works. Because demon eyes of somebody who's becoming popular, lots of people like him, and suddenly he's tarred with this brush. You don't like the people who are doing that to your new good friend Tony Blair.
But M&C Saatchi had wanted to go even further than demon eyes in a commercial.
How can I win?
And employed a Faustian-type figure to stop Blair getting into number 10.
Four times in a row we've lost. Now they've made me Labour leader in order to win. We've got to win or I'm finished. But how?
The idea of the broadcast was a man, rather like Tony Blair, being advised by a PR type, Mandelson-type figure, as to what he would need to say to get elected.
I can show you how to win.
Who are you?
Doesn't matter. I can show you how to win.
If you see the whole of the film, what you see is a complete grasp of what he was going to do. Pretend to be what people wanted while doing whatever he felt like doing.
You can say anything.
What do you mean?
Say you won't put up taxes.
But I will.
So what? Just say it. Go on, it's easy.
I know I'd have to put up taxes.
Just say it. Say it.
I won't put up taxes.
You heard this shadowy figure behind him saying, yes, you can.
Say it.
It's yes, you can. Just tell them what they want to hear.
So
it was the sort of selling your soul and not being honest creative point of view, it was a powerful piece of communication, but it was decided that it was just too unpleasant, too risky in that respect.
You don't have to mean it. You don't have to do it. Just say it.
Major just thought it would cause a terrible controversy for no purpose.
Yes.
I mean, you have to understand that whole campaign was run by a collection of people who all knew that we were going to lose.
New Labour won 178-seat majority.
New dawn has broken, has it not?
They'd spent a record £7 million on advertising.
A truly terrible night for the Conservatives.
But the new dawn didn't make their advertising any less personal. In power, New Labour recruited Trevor Beatty, the man behind the uplifting Wonder Bra ads. In the 2001 election, Beatty produced an ad ridiculing the balding Conservative leader William Hague, giving him a wig to look like a Thatcherite clone. And when Michael Howard took over the leadership, New Labour had to rebut charges of anti-Semitism.
So far this year, they've compared me to Fagin, to Shylock, and to a flying pig.
The campaign from time to time gets hard, and you have to be tough in the way you campaign. And I'm afraid that sometimes you have to have some tough negative campaigning to go with the positive campaigning. The necessity was in the 2005 election, which, although we won it comfortably, was actually much, much, much closer. I mean, you're talking about a majority going down from the 150s, 160s to the 60s.
I think more and more, actually, it reflects how politics is, which is about the cult of the personality. I personally don't. I think it's legitimate. I think that, you know, it is individuals and who make decisions, personalities who make decisions. So why shouldn't it be about their personality and about the individuals?
As admin, you've earned a fortune in fees and commissions working for the political parties over the years. But what will tomorrow bring? At the last election, newspaper ads, billboards, and television were vital. Now, the internet is the growing medium.
Mm-hmm.
It was a creed written into the founding documents that declared the destiny of a nation. Yes, we can.
This is a web political advertisement for Democratic presidential nominee Barack Obama. Will I Am from the popular US hip-hop group Black Eyed Peas turned one of his speeches into a song. Millions of young Americans have watched it. But it didn't cost Obama a dime. The idea came from Will I Am himself, who wanted to influence the election.
It's trite, superficial. And maybe that's how political advertising is going to go, and then maybe that's what is presented to us nowadays.
Yes, we can.
I mean, you know, you catch it, and then, I think it had 6 million hits on the first night. Well, certainly in the first week. You can see it growing. Everybody's talking about it, so everybody will go on it. It's not about anything.
If Obama makes it to the White House, this could become the most popular means for getting across a political message.
Remember, advertising is a transmission system. What we're learning from the web is that it needs to be interactive, so we need new techniques, and I think we will see an evolution of communication to do in the web space what was done by Saatchi's on the poster space.
Today is the 9th anniversary of Tony Blair coming to power, and I want to talk to you straight.
But then one day, a tiny crack appeared, and David...
In Britain, all the political parties now have an internet presence, but they can only dream of reaching the numbers who've watched Yes We Can.
So David joined some other little blue chums in a little blue party called the Conservatives.
I think the internet will be an interesting additional tool. I don't think it'll replace all traditional media when it comes to communication. But I don't think that the role of advertising communication during campaigns is going to diminish.
For the moment, traditional forms of political propaganda are as necessary as the photo opportunity and the soundbite. But unlike Coke is it, Nike's Just Do It, or L'Oreal's Because You're Worth It, the political party's ad men have only created a handful of memorable campaigns, and for the most part, they have had little lasting impact.
So much rides on the outcome. They'll do it just in case it's going to work. On top of which, actually, elections are trench warfare. I mean, if both sides didn't do it, it probably wouldn't make a difference, but the other side is going to do it. So if they're lobbing shells at you, if you don't lob shells back, they probably will make some gains on your territory, so you need to lob some shells back. And on the whole, these two cancel each other out and nothing changes. So I think, broadly, that's probably what happens in most elections.
Do you remember any of the broadcasts in particular that you've seen?
Oh, I don't know. I can't think of them straight away. I look at them and I remember them, then I forget them.